all right, I'll check and make sure. Yep. All right, good morning, everyone. Whether you are a member or friend in the sanctuary or viewing the service online, we are happy that you chose to join us. We extend a special welcome to visitors here with us today, and please let us know if there's anything we can do to help you feel more comfortable. If you would like to receive our weekly email newsletter, you can fill one of these cards out. Let me get that in front of you in the seat back, and you will begin to receive our email newsletter. The Unitarian Universalist Church of Flint is an inclusive, LGBTQ-affirming church. Our ministers, Revlynn Kerr and Revjerry Kerr, would be pleased to help you learn more about Unitarian Universalism and this congregation. You can contact them through the office at uuflint.org. Today's announcements are on the back of your order of service. We have a very full service today, so I encourage you to look at those. Our service today is a solemn memorial for the many thousands who die or are injured each year due to gun violence. In our service, we strive to avoid debating all the very familiar, frequently proposed solutions to gun violence. We all know them by heart. Rather, we are here to reaffirm that the vast majority of human beings want to preserve life and not end it, and that we must stop and learn how to stop the killing. I wanted to get to the stop part. We will now light our chalice for this morning's service. We light this flame of life, in affirmation of the strength that is ours to live this day and the potential we have to create a better tomorrow. And now, if you'll join me in reciting our covenant. Recognizing the richness of diversity, the beauty and wonder of shared worship, and the transforming power of love and service, we gather as a sacred, intentional community to freely seek knowledge and truth, to celebrate the fullness of life, and by our actions to increase goodness and justice.
Thank you. Holy and beautiful is the custom which brings us together today. To face our ideals, to remember our loved ones, to give thanks, to make confession, to offer forgiveness, to be enlightened and to be strengthened. Through this quiet hour breathes the worship of the ages, the cathedral music of history. In faith, three guests attend: love, justice, and reason. Let our hearts prepare them a place. Stand if you like for our opening hymn.
Good morning. Today's candle lighting ceremony at the front of the sanctuary will be a memorial for those who have died by gun violence. If today, just today, if you have a personal joy or concern, we ask that you light a candle at the rear of the sanctuary. The numbers are astounding and dreadfully consistent. In our country, approximately 40,000 people die by the gun every year, and another approximately 40,000 to 60,000 are injured every year. The victims are children shot while attending school. They are people who commit suicide in an impulsive moment. They are impoverished youth who, out of desperation, choose violence. They are people sitting on their front porch, relaxing. They are children shot by a sibling who discovered a gun in mommy's purse. They are murder victims. They are everywhere. They are from all walks of life. Before we honor those who have died, let us sit for a time in silence. Today we will light 10 candles, each candle symbolizing 4,000 of the 40,000 Americans who die from gun violence each year. a poem from Carl Sandburg. My head knocks against the stars. My feet are on the hilltops. My fingertips are in the valleys and shores of universal life. Down in the sounding foam of primal things, I reach my hands and play with pebbles of destiny. I've been to hell and back many times. I know all about heaven, for I have talked with God. I dabble in the blood and guts of the terrible. I know the passionate seizure of beauty and the marvelous rebellion of man at all signs reading, "Keep off." My name is Truth, and I am the most elusive captive in the universe.
J.R.R. Tolkien's book, The Hobbit, is a mythic tale of every person's quest to defeat the monsters that haunt them. Gandalf and his band of adventurers enter an underground lair of the trolls. They find beautiful ancient swords and claim them for their own. Later, the ageless and wise elf, Elrond, reveals the long history of the swords. Elrond knew all about runes of every kind. He looked at the swords we had brought from the troll's lair, and he said, "These are not troll-made. They are old swords, very old swords of the high elves of the West, my kin, and were made in Gondolin for the Goblin Wars. They must have come from a dragon's hoard or goblin plunder, for dragons and goblins destroyed that city many ages ago. On Yorsthorn, the runes say in the ancient tongue of Gondolin, 'Orcrist, the goblin cleaver.' It was a famous blade. Yours, Gandalf, is Glamdring, foe hammer, that the king of Gondolin once wore. Keep them well." "Whence did the trolls get them, I wonder?" said Thorin, looking at his sword with new interest. "I could not say," said Elrond, "but one may guess that the trolls had plundered other plunderers and come on the remnants of old robberies in some hold in the mountains of the north. I have heard there are still forgotten treasures of old to be found in the deserted caverns, hidden there in the mines of Moria." Thorin pondered these words. "I will keep this sword in honor," he said. "May it cleave goblins once again." "A wish that is likely to be granted soon enough in the mountains," said Elrond. "But show me now your map." The following is a poem about America and guns. I think it presents a simple, straightforward fact. England is a cup of tea. France is a wheel of ripened brie. Greece is a short, squat olive tree. America is a gun. Brazil is football on the sand. Argentina, Maradona's hand. Germany, an oompa band. America is a gun. Holland is a wooden shoe. Hungary, a goulash stew. Australia, a kangaroo. America is a gun. Japan is a thermal spring. Scotland is a Highland fling. But for the worse or better thing, America is a gun. It's just a fact. When it comes to the number and ease of getting firearms, there is no nation on earth like America. That fact and one other brings us together today. The vast majority of Americans, including most gun owners, are horrified by what bullets do to people's bodies and to the lives of those who love them. Strongly held, red-faced arguments over what we must do to stop bullets from hitting bodies don't seem to do much except raise everyone's blood pressure. Today, partly out of desperation, I suggest we try something different. Let us, together, search for the very deepest roots of gun violence, where the unthinkable starts to grow. Perhaps, together, we will have a realization that could someday make America known for something other than a gun. I've mentioned before that my fascination, even love affair, with guns is in my DNA. That is also true for many people in America, especially for my generation. If you are around 70 years old or older, and your family lived in the country when you were young, some of your very recent ancestors probably had a gun or two, maybe went hunting. My great uncle Willard took the following pictures in the early 20s. This was said to be the last wolf in Logan County, Ohio. He's strung up over a rifle, if you can see. Note the little girl standing intently looking at the poor dead wolf. You have to wonder, what was she thinking? And the guys, they look pretty proud. They had to get that wolf, and yes, a wolf like that could eat a lot of your chickens or eat the rabbits that you want to eat. Gun ownership in our country is all tied up with the idea of the heroism of supporting and protecting the family, protecting them from bad things, both real and imaginary. It is said that America had a frontier somewhere or other for hundreds of years. And people on the frontiers always had a gun or two. There are many other countries, for example, those known for a cup of tea or a wooden shoe, where that was not the case. America grew up with the idea that you might need a firearm to shoot unruly slaves, shoot unruly indigenous people, and unruly wolves. They also wanted to shoot something to eat, and yes, eradicate millions of bison for immense profit. A tradition like that doesn't just go away. This is Charlie Schultz, who lost his right arm in a farm accident when he was a boy. He still ran his trap line, though, and carried his rifle. Looking at these old photos when I was young passed on the ideal of the armed woodsman and I tried running a trap line myself for all of 2 days. I caught a little muskrat and could not bear to look into his eyes when I shot it. Sensibilities do change over the decades, and the overhead cost to me from seeing the suffering was the greater than my need for pocket money. So that old tradition died in the Kerr cultural DNA. Our next slide is one of the Jackson clan with the supper he brought down with his shotgun. The Jacksons still claim they are related to the Kerrs, which we strongly deny. I won't go into that right now. And the next slide is of me with my first kill. There we go. It's a squirrel. Bringing home the meat like a good son. Now, Dad did not say to me, "Today you are a man." But he should have, because that is what he was thinking. That is why he took the picture. And if he had said, "Today you are a man, Jerry," I would have understood much sooner that in America, manhood is associated with shooting things. If there had been an actual ritual, perhaps he would have put some of the squirrel's blood on my face even. If we had had a ritual, I could have thought about it more, about whether I agreed with that ideal. Heroic gun ownership is still a deeply rooted American ideal. And even though there are no more frontiers, thankfully no Indians to shoot, as though we should have anyhow, and even though only a tiny percentage of Americans need to shoot their food, America is still a gun. A story that makes me look silly may help us find another root, perhaps the taproot of American gun violence. I've looked silly many times before, so this is no big deal. In 1968, when I was 14, our house in Ohio developed a bad case of bats. This was a long time before people understood that these little creatures, who only a saint could call cute, are a vital part of our world. They would swirl around our house at twilight in large numbers until it looked like Dracula's castle. For some reason, bats inspire unreasonable fear in many people. Dad was sure they would find their way into our attic. At least that was his excuse. He was an avid sportsman, and shooting flying objects, quail, pheasants, clay pigeons at the weekly summer trap shoot, all of that led to the conclusion that these bats should be shot down. We had no shortage of guns and ammo up in our gun room. And yes, a room in our house was called the gun room. So at dusk, on several soft summer nights, Dad and his three boys, all armed with shotguns of various descriptions, bravely went forth to do battle against our perceived evil enemy. It is very difficult to hit a bat on the wing, so this also became a kind of game, although I'm sure the bats didn't like the game. Now I know what you Michiganders are thinking. This could only happen in Ohio. But I don't think so. Our closest neighbor was nearly a mile away, and they probably wondered what the sounds of war were all about. On the other hand, the sound of gunfire frequently emanated from our property. Dad was always testing out his latest batch of hand-loaded ammo, so the neighbors probably thought nothing of the gunfire. In any case, the bats never entered our attic. They probably wouldn't have anyhow. And I assure you, it wasn't because we killed all of them. Fast forward 17 years, and I had my own house near Lakeview, Ohio. It soon became evident that I had the same problem, only worse. In the early spring, we heard scratching inside the walls of our newly purchased old farmhouse. A colony of bats were awaking from their winter's sleep. Never mind that now I knew you could rid your house of bats by simply plugging up all of their holes under the eaves, except for one. Wait for the bats to exit one night, and then you go out and plug up the final hole. No more bats. Never mind that easy, common sense solution. I had a short-barreled Remington 870 riot shotgun with an extended magazine, and when I wielded it, I was pest control Steve McQueen. Of course, Dad came up to help me after first going up to his gun room and loading up some special shells with number 10 shot. I will spare you the gory details. I don't know how we kept from shooting each other. My neighbors of 1/2 mile away stopped one day while I was at the mailbox and asked all about the guns going off at nightfall. I told them the story, very matter-of-factly. Just shooting bats, rapid fire, when they come out at sundown. They replied politely, "Oh, sure, sure." I'm quite sure they did not see me as Steve McQueen. They probably saw me as Bill Murray in Caddyshack, blowing up gophers with plastic explosives. We all like to think we know why we do things. And we like to think we know why other people do things. We like to think we are in control of ourselves and are always at least somewhat logical. Speaking for myself, it took me years to fully understand why I thought I had to shoot those bats. The deeply seated root of my actions, I just wanted to hear that gun go off, see what it would do. It was not a crime, except against nature, which is no small thing. But my point is, a gun and the culture I grew up in took over from common sense. And I know my example might sound trivial, but what I'm describing happens frequently in America with horrific results. People with guns are often moved by unconscious motives and they come out shooting. And even worse, some shooters seem to have no motive of any kind. The 2017 shooter in Las Vegas, who killed 58 people from his sniper's perch on a tall building, he was simply bored with life. He apparently wanted to ensure his name would live on after his death. A 2014 study by the FBI shows that many mass shooters are not mentally ill, but shoot people because they feel alienated. They are narcissistic, have poor coping skills, a low tolerance for frustration, a lack of trust, or are fascinated with violence-filled entertainment. They have negative role models, low self-esteem, ready access to weapons, and a tendency to manipulate others. Other studies echo these findings, but still, after each news report tells us the authorities are still searching for the shooter's motive. Of course, that phrase implies the shooter always knows what he is doing, and that we will finally figure it out ourselves. Yes, we all like to think we know why people do things so we can make sense of the world and perhaps manage it. We might wonder, though, And I ask you sincerely, what effect would it have on Americans if the news reports instead said, the authorities are still searching to see if the shooter had a motive? That would be more truthful, and it would certainly get people's attention. That fair statement poses several obvious questions. How do we stop the killing when shooters can be just about anyone who has, for instance, a low tolerance for frustration or has low self-esteem? How can we stop the killing when shooters can have no motive other than the hope that killing will make them feel powerful and manly? It seems to me that Americans just don't appreciate the amazing, often irrational, emotional, sometimes unconscious human mind. And that is a problem when dealing with gun violence. At the moment, some think it is logical to have active shooter drills because they might save the lives of at least some school children. But now, studies show that the drills cause serious psychological damage to the children. And no amount of rational, logical assurances that this is just a drill, honey, will keep a child from storing in their unconscious mind the message, I could get shot. So, do we save their bodies with the drills that include sometimes fake blood and just tell them, we are sorry we scarred you emotionally for life? What a choice. Perhaps, maybe, hopefully, an increased understanding of the human mind will lead people to find some other solutions. It seems that when speaking on this topic of the unconscious mind, I am doomed to tell stories from my own sometimes unconscious, illogical, gun-toting behavior. I will do it again, though, for the good of the cause, and because I know you are a forgiving audience, mostly. Here's a rifle that was a favorite toy of mine that I recently sold. That was not easy, but I needed it like I needed a hole in the head. I call it a toy because there is nothing you can do with it except to see how accurately you can shoot it. You can't take it squirrel hunting or on your trap line if you have one. It is not a home defense weapon. You can't shoot a pheasant with it or even an elk. It is too heavy to carry anywhere, so you need a military Humvee to haul it. It is simply a weapon of war. Now you can relax. I have never shot anything with it except innocent paper targets. So I'm not making any really big confessions. Buying and equipping this rifle with several years of what used to be called butter and egg money was not entirely irrational. It's like they say, everyone has to have a hobby, and a rifle marksmanship has been my hobby for a long time. It started with another today you are a man moment. It was when I got a powerful pellet gun for Christmas at the age of 12. Having such a weapon of war comes with serious fantasy baggage. Was this the glamdring we heard about in today's reading from The Hobbit? What real or imaginary goblins could it kill? Now I'm sure many an AR-15 has been dubbed glamdring. Never mind that The Hobbit is a mythic story about killing the selfish, evil goblins that inhabit the human mind. People name their boats, their airplanes. Some name their guitars. But naming your rifle glamdring is a bit much, I think. So I named my favorite rifle Mjolnir. Mjolnir is, of course, the name of Thor's hammer. Now that is a proper, classical, mythological name for a rifle. I will go no further with my own confessions, but will show you some interesting marketing campaigns that support monster-killing fantasies. I'm sure they will make you think a bit. The hit TV series The Walking Dead started in 2010, and the gun industry took notice. What unconscious fears can we exploit to sell our goods? Some gun makers featured zombies in their ads, saying, "You need to buy this gun to be truly prepared for the coming zombie apocalypse." Now, of course, no one buying one of these guns would admit they did so because of the advertising. No way. People deny they believe in zombies, of course, but if they were self-aware, they would realize they do believe in some formless, fearful thing. So, out of their ill-informed fear, they bring a weapon into their house that is far more dangerous than the menace itself. Here's one of the many zombie targets you can buy. I may have a few gun fantasies, some silliness that I'm aware of, but I use standard targets. We have a picture of one here, so no worries. There's some real hope that American can be something more than a gun. A strong majority of Americans now say they want to do something. And our lawmakers here in Michigan are passing laws that may help. To me, those things don't seem threatening at all. And we will probably have to do much more. I personally hope we will, and I think I have proven I am a gun enthusiast, or at least was. I'm in the process of selling my guns because I don't want to be exactly like my father, who I adored, but he thought he was going to take his guns to the grave. I swear. Yes, I think there is cause for hope because we have conquered problems rooted in people's irrational fears many times in our history. Many people were afraid to free their slaves, afraid to free women, afraid to do what it took to clean the air and water. Others were afraid to free people who were LGBTQ. People were scared to give workers their human rights because it would cost them a buck. And the list goes on and on. But the fears were groundless, and compassion and love and everybody and each individual won when their fears were conquered. Together, all of us can do this and save lives. Thank you.
It's a little bit funny, this feeling inside. Not one of those who can easily hide. Don't have much money, but boy, if I did, I'd buy a big house where we both could live. If I was a sculptor, but then again, no, or a man who makes potions in a traveling show. No, it's not much, but it's the best I can do. My gift is my song, and this one's for you. You can tell everybody this is your song. It may be quite simple, but now that it's done, I hope you don't mind, I hope you don't mind that I put down in words. How wonderful life is when you're in the world. Sat on the roof, kicked off the moss with a few of the verses. Well, they've got me quite cross, but the sun's been quite kind while I wrote this song. For people like you that keep it turned on. So excuse me for getting, but these things I do. See, I've forgotten if they're green or they're blue. Anyway, the thing is, what I really mean, yours are the sweetest eyes I've ever seen. And you can tell everybody this is a song. It may be quite simple, but now that it's done, oh, why? I hope you don't mind, I hope you don't mind that I put down in words how
the time in our service for generosity. We affirm the goodness of this world, share our joy for life, and stand on the side of love. We also share our time, talent, and treasure to continue being a loving presence in this community. We invite you to join us as we take the collection by placing your offering in the basket at the back of the church as you leave, or by making an online donation at uuflint.org. We thank you.
Our closing words are from Albert Schweitzer. Reverence for Life says that the only thing we are really sure of is that we live and want to go on living. This is something that we share with everything else that lives, from elephants to blades of grass, and of course, every human being. So we are brothers and sisters to all living things, and owe to all of them the same care and respect that we wish for ourselves.
And let us extinguish our chalice.
We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts until we are together again.
Thank you. Thanks for being with us. And we'd like to open this up for a brief discussion. If you would like to leave